All right, the Audible is on the air. It's a Wednesday afternoon. Big week for the Miami Dolphins. This is the Audible presented by our good friends at Aquafina. If you're watching us, you're watching us on Periscope. You can send your questions in if you'd like on your Periscope page. Just go ahead where it says message down there. Get that done. If you're checking us out on Twitter, you can go ahead and sign on to a Periscope account and get yourself involved in that. You can also watch us on a rebroadcast beginning tomorrow morning on the Miami Dolphins Facebook page. And you can always catch us later this afternoon on MiamiDolphins.com. Joining us now, the CEO of the Dolphins Cancer Challenge, Michael Mandich. And Mike, big weekend this weekend. Saturday's the big ride day. And boy, it's amazing how big this event has grown. You've been involved with it from the outset. And here we are. Yeah. This is what, the sixth year?
This is year seven. Year seven. Believe it or not. I mean, it feels like yesterday that we started this as a little dream and concept. Yep. And it's now turned into five bike rides, 5K, a concert with the Counting Crows. Yep. And raising millions and millions of dollars.
Amazing. I mean, well over $16 million going into this bike ride this weekend.
Yeah.
And I know your goal is somewhere around the $5 million range.
It's over that. Last year we raised nearly $5.1 million. Yep. This year we're already pacing well past that, and we hope that continues.
So that's nice. So you're going to be over $20 million.
Yes.
Well over $20 million after this ride's over with.
Oh, confidently.
Very nice. Talk about building this thing up, how it's come along and how it's gone this big. And then look, it's still time for people to get involved. If you want to participate, whether you want to participate in the 5K walk, whether you want to participate as a virtual rider, and maybe I'm speaking out of turn. If I'm not, go ahead and let me know. I don't know if people can still get in and ride if they want to ride.
They can.
It's two days away.
Yeah, they can until tomorrow.
Okay.
And then we close the ride. And then the 5K will be open.
It's walk up on
Saturday morning.
So there's plenty of opportunities for you to raise funds. Look, you can just, if you want to go to, it's DCC.com, right?
DolphinsCancerChallenge.com or go Google Dolphins Cancer Challenge. And, we come up right there. But this is really brought to by many, many partners in the community. Most notably, the Miami Dolphins.
Yep.
It's really not possible. I mean, think about the usage that we do. We're going to finish in the Hard Rock Stadium this year. The first time in 3 years that we've done that. I know it's very special. We're going to have the concert on the field, and we expect over 3,500 participants to either bike, walk, run this weekend. In addition, people are just coming out for the concert, so they're buying $50 tickets to show up, watch the Counting Crows, and they're big fans of that. So you even get a mix of this group, just the donations, the enthusiasm this year is unlike any other.
Yeah, look, we've certainly been touched by cancer. I'm sure everybody that's watching this program somewhere or another, if you haven't yet, will be touched by cancer. And you don't need to participate in order to help out. In other words, if you go to DolphinsCancerChallenge.com, look, I'm sure that you can just grab a rider, figure out some way, and just say, hey, let me
donate to Kim Bokamper.
Yeah, exactly. Donate to me.
This guy's doing 25 miles.
I'm lagging behind on my fundraising, but I usually get my fundraising after the fact. I get people I kind of twist their arms to send in. But yeah, so you can go on. Look, if you don't want to ride, if you're out of state, if you're out of the country, if you're not anywhere near, but you're watching the program, you can always go on to Dolphins Cancer Challenge. Look for a way to spend. Look, if it's $5, $10, whatever it is, it means something. And when you put it all together, it really is meaningful. And Michael, not only, away from the bike ride, University of Miami, Sylvester Cancer, and what they've done for research in cancer and help improve our community down here in South Florida. And that's where all the money that's raised for this event stays in South Florida. They've done so much, and they've made so many advances towards trying to eliminate this disease. And we've talked about it before. Look, they haven't eliminated the disease, but for a lot of us, they've given us more time with people that have been touched by cancer, that time that you can spend with them. And I've always said to me, every minute, when you find somebody, when you've got somebody in your family that's been diagnosed with cancer, as soon as they're diagnosed, every minute is valuable to you. And so if you can, if what we donate through the Miami Dolphins Cancer Challenge can extend somebody's life a day, 2 days, 2 weeks, 2 months, 2 years, then I think we're moving in the right direction.
Absolutely. And nearly a week doesn't go by without somebody contacting me with with a little bit of a desperation and need for them or their family member, their grandparents, you name it. And I love hearing the success stories back from them with the way that they were treated, with the quality of care, the personability, you know, of the physicians, of the staff, you name it. It all trickles down. But when you hear somebody say that they're cancer free, you know that what you're doing right now and the dollars that we're raising are making an impact. Like they're directly making an impact on these people's lives. And I think that brings me the greatest joy.
No doubt about it. And you know, it's funny. It's for me, the, you know, I talk about the ride and everyone talks about the ride and whether you're riding 25 or 50 something or 100, however far you're riding. And I've done most of the different distances. That first ride to that first water stop, that first rest stop that you get to, that first portion of the whole ride for me is really meaningful because it's kind of you're seeing people, hey, how you doing? Mm-hmm. And you start hearing their stories, you know? Hey, I'm riding for my wife back in Houston who's battling breast cancer. Or, you know, hey, I'm a cancer survivor. I had cancer 2 years ago, couldn't ride in the ride, but here I am now. So all those stories seem to be told in that first 15 miles, you know, where you get that first rest stop. And you're really kind of, I've made connections almost each and every ride with somebody during that first stretch that every year beyond that, I start looking for them. I look for them to reconnect with them and everything. So it's more than just a ride. And I know you talk about it a lot. It's not a race. No. It's a ride. It's you know, it's just an opportunity to mingle and get around people that are committed to the same type of thing you get. And it's so much more enjoyable than just riding a bike. And there's so many more things coming out of it than helping donate money to Sylvester. It's connecting with people that have been in similar situations as you and I and a lot of other people out there have.
Yeah, it's a little program that we started this year is we have I Fight For on the back of everyone's jersey. So people were able to submit who they're fighting for. I'm fighting for the Mad Dog. Mm-hmm. You're fighting for your wife and many others. Yep. We've received thousands of people that are you know, why they're riding.
Yeah.
And it just is really neat to see, you know, all those different things, you know, hey, my son, my daughter, my grandparents, my aunt, whether they're living or not, you know, and when you see all those names, they'll be pressed on Friday night. We'll have a nice kickoff party in the Hyundai Club at the Hard Rock Stadium. So I think it's all those little elements of how we can deliver a story and an experience. But the people are what really
drive
it.
It really is phenomenal. I mean, I've met people from all around the country that come out to support. And you know, you in the past you've had a big sign of some sort where people can write down who they're writing for, and it's always amazing just before you kind of head out, you look at that board and how many names are on there and how much it's filled out, and it really brings home the impact of how many people have been touched that are involved in this ride.
Yes, and I feel like in some of the cases I see, like you mentioned, a person one time a year. I see at the DCC. And we have that bond that, hey, we go out, we ride, and I catch up on them. I hear how their life story is over that past year, and I give them a little bit of, hey, you know, this is what I've been going. Yep. And I think we always share that common thread. Maybe we don't live in the same area, but we're cancer fighters, and we're here to stamp out cancer. Yep.
You know, it's funny that one of my favorite things about it was 2 years ago when we were leaving out of the stadium to go on up to Palm Beach. You had a guy from that rode the Tour de France.
Oh yeah, right? George Hincapie.
George Hincapie, he ran the Tour de France. So as we're getting out, I look up ahead and about, you know, a little ways up there is George riding. So I kind of picked it up and I just wanted to ride. I just want to say I passed a guy that rode in the Tour de
just
France
in the warm up, right?
And then I realized it took me so much to catch up with him. I had to lay back a little bit and catch up a little bit.
A little winded on that one. That's all right.
No doubt about it.
Hey, listen, that's why it's a ride, not a race. I mean, because Listen, I learned very early on when I was riding with George that there was a reason why I wasn't a pro cyclist.
Well, you know, it's funny. I was down, we were down in Miami, Brickell area somewhere, as we're kind of heading our way to Coconut Grove at one point. And I'm riding along with a guy, and he's telling me about how, there's a lot of guys riding that are really competitive riders and stuff like that. And I looked over at him, and this guy, he couldn't have weighed more than this microphone, you know? And so I'm going, well, let me ask you something. I said, are you ride a lot? He goes, yeah, I ride competitively. And I said, how much do you weigh? He goes, I weigh 139 pounds or something.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what? And I go, what about? He goes, all those guys weigh, you know, when you
plus
look
two,
at,
plus 200 yeah. pounders, you got no shot. I mean, no, you don't realize, man. you know how you have to be.
Yeah, like, well, you look like at them, they got no upper body.
No.
They're all butt and legs, and their legs are just...
Like
tight
my dad
and strong
said,
and
too much dupa. Too much butt.
Yeah, good stuff. Hey, you're watching the Audible. You're watching on Periscope, presented by Aquafina. If you want to send your questions in, just in the bottom of your page in Periscope, you can go ahead and send your questions in, and you can watch us on a delayed broadcast on the Miami Dolphins Facebook page tomorrow and later today on MiamiDolphins.com. Let's take a couple questions here. And this is a perfect one for you. At Take the Pen. Have you considered selling the bike jersey separately for us that don't live in Miami? Is there an opportunity
online?
Actually,
we do. Yeah. We sell the jerseys, not this current year. Yes. We will eventually sell the current year at DolphinsCancerChallenge.com, and they're top quality jerseys. It's a way for people.
So you got some of the past rides that you had jerseys that are left that people can go ahead and go to MiamiDolphinsCancerChallenge.com and order those. Go to the pro shop there or whatever
we sell them online. So people buy them. I love going out and doing a training ride and I see 15, 20 of those jerseys sitting out there throughout South Florida. That's the best feeling.
You know, I live in Plantation and there's a lot of riders out there, and it seems like every time I see a group of riders, I see somebody that's wearing a Dolphin Cancer Challenge jersey.
People are proud about it.
Yeah,
because, listen, you know, not only the ride is something that you have to prepare for, but a lot of people, you know, put in a big effort on the fundraising aspect. Yeah. And so they want to broadcast to the world that, you know, hey, this is what I stand for.
Yeah. You know, and it's funny, you talk about sponsors, and I was just with some of the people from Lennar when we were up in Pittsburgh, and you talk about people that have really jumped in. Stuart Miller has jumped in up to his neck in this thing, and over the years, Lennar has been a great partner in this and raised a lot of money. But Michael, there's a lot of groups around South Florida that have formulated teams that have done a great deal to bring this type of money to the table, and each and every one of those sponsors certainly deserve all the credit in the world.
Yeah, we have over 170 teams participate, some small, some large. Yes, Team Lennar is one of our largest, and actually the chairman, Eric Fader, this year works with Lennar and Rialto Capital, but Stewart way behind it, and many, many others. Yep. I don't want to single the Lennar folks out, yet they are just, I mean, they're a cornerstone of this event. And in addition, we have hundreds of teams that come out, participate. Yep. They have their own little flair about it, too, man. You don't want to get about that.
No, it's great. It's good stuff. It's that you get there in the morning to get ready to go, and it's just looking around at people and the way they've got themselves ready to go. It's I actually took off on the ride last year with Mike Tannenbaum and his wife.
Yep.
And we took off from Boca Raton last year.
And they'll be participating again. And actually, guess who's participating this year? Our owner, Stephen M. Ross.
Oh, is he?
He's riding from camp down to the training.
Oh, nice.
Down to the Hard Rock. So
excellent.
First time in a few years he's participated, and we're excited to have him and many others participate.
Yeah, it really is a great afternoon. Another question at Puro Signon. Hey, Bo, what's your favorite part of the off season? Well, a bike ride is one of my favorite parts of the off season, to tell you the truth. I like that. But, you know, I'm a little bit of a geek. So for the off season, you know what I love? I love when the combine comes.
Yeah.
I'll look at the
NFL. The stats?
NFL Network. Sit there on my couch. I'll watch 2-3 hours a day of just guys running drills. I love every minute of it.
You like them in the spandex, and
I like seeing guys running drills. What I would prefer, if you know, for me with the combine, I would prefer that these guys go to the combine and have no idea what drills they're going to run. Mm-hmm. Just adapt yourself. Here's what we're going to do. You're going to do this drill. Maybe you've never seen it before. It's done. Here's how you do it. go do it.
Then you because can see you how, know you got to do the 40. You know you got to do the high jump.
But look, the way it is now, like there are guys now, there's, you know, most of the guys that are going to the combine that have gotten out, once they finish college football, their college football season, all they've been doing is going to, I know Bomarito has a place down in Aventura. A lot of guys have them in Arizona. All around the country, there are these guys that basically take you in and teach you how to do the combine. You run the same drills.
It's
you
like know, studying for the SAT.
It's like an open book test, So my thing is, hey, look, don't tell them what drills you're going to run.
Yeah.
Because, look, quite frankly, you bring a guy here and say, okay, here's the drill. You've got to do this and this and this. And if the guy can't figure it out, first thing I'm going is, I don't want him on my team.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, you know, there's more to it than that. So I just think going out and spending months trying to shave a tenth of a second off of a drill, you know, in doing it, you know,
does that make you a better football player?
Yeah. Or as a team, does that make you know that guy's a better football player if he's been drilling on that one drill, you know, for 3 months
hundreds
now?
Hundreds of repetitions.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
I mean, come on. I remember when you know when there was no combine, there was no none of that stuff, and you know you'd be at college and you'd get a call from the coach, hey, the guy from the Raiders wants to work you out, and you go down to the football field, put your stuff on, and then just do whatever he says to do, and that's so that's kind of the school I came from. I think it's a better. But anyway, I don't know why I got off that, but that is one of my favorite parts of the season. Joey Bag of Donuts. Hey, Bo and Mike, what's the craziest story while you were riding?
Ooh.
Craziest story you've seen while you're riding?
The craziest story while riding? I mean,
Plenty of flats.
There's seen plenty of flats. Unfortunately, I've seen a couple accidents.
Yeah.
You know, but I think probably some of the crazier stories are what people have overcome.
Yes.
Yeah. Like, there's a guy named George Fetko, and he was near on his deathbed.
Yeah.
He was an avid cyclist before, and he owes Sylvester just his life.
Yeah.
You know, he was stage four and looking pretty grim.
Yeah.
And now he's back, and he's like leading the pack at the front of the group in the 100. I love hearing that. And then there's a guy named Jim Saya, who carries his son
a hundred miles,
and
it's amazing.
I mean, it's hard enough doing the bike on your own.
Yeah.
Carry 165 pounds, and I promise you, it'll test your mettle real quick.
Yeah, no, that's I was going to bring him up because I've seen him over the years, and it's a touching story, and it's amazing to see that kind of commitment from one individual to another. You know?
He has just unconditional love for his son, who unfortunately, you know, is just he's an invalid.
Yeah.
And but he's the nicest. He works at the stadium on game days, and so I love that story. And there's hundreds of others that I might not even be aware of.
We were riding one time. I was going to ride. I meant to ride the 100. This was when we were going from here, from the stadium to Palm Beach for the 100-mile ride.
Okay.
And we actually had to leave that day to go to Kansas City.
Yeah.
Because the Dolphins were playing Kansas City on the Sunday. This was a Saturday. And so we had booked. We didn't go on the charter. We had booked flight out of Palm Beach.
Okay.
I think it was me. It was Greaseball. The year Greaseball rolled and broke his wrist.
That's because he was riding on the sidewalk,
you know. And so we're riding, and I'm going along pretty good. And I get to the 80 mile rest stop. I think.
Yeah.
So I get to the 80 mile rest stop. I'm going. I'm good. I get 20 miles to go. You know, no problem. I went about 5 more miles, and I mean, I couldn't, I just, my body just quit on me. It just quit. I stopped the bike right there, you know, laid it down. I couldn't pedal one more pedal. I called up. I said, hey, someone's going to have to come pick me up.
my brother Nick, I do have the credit. He did make it to the end.
Yeah.
But the 1 year, he required 2 IV fluids.
Yeah.
And because, he had a couple beers the day before.
Not a good idea.
Yeah, not a good idea, especially if you haven't trained. And then, you know, it's warmer out by the time you start getting to the end of that 100 miles. Boy, he was cramping so bad, he could hardly move.
Another time I had a bad pair of shoes, and my feet felt like they were literally on fire. They were burning so much, you know. So we got to one of the rest stops. I took them off, And man, damn, I didn't want to put them
better
back
than
on
the nether region, I guess. Yeah. The good bike shorts.
No. I got good bike shorts. I've never had a problem. I've had a problem south of the border, all the way down to my feet, but never in the midsection. I've never had a problem. So. At McLovin, what time is the 5K?
It's 11 a.m.
11 a.m.
So we have a walk-up registration. It'll open up around 9 a.m.
So you can show up at the stadium at Hard Rock Stadium about 9 o'clock. You can sign up to get in the 5K, and that's been a nice addition for you guys. You did that. It's been 2 years now you've done the 5K.
We've done two. This is year three for us, and we'll have over 1,500 people participate just in the 5K. Yeah. All walks of life.
Don't need to run. Old. You can walk, whatever.
Just strollers, kids are welcome.
Yeah.
I do want to state that kids 12 and under are entered in for free, and it includes food and beverage, the concert, and 100%, and we haven't mentioned, but 100% of every dollar our participants raise goes directly to fund cancer research at Sylvester.
Yeah, that is true. I mean, you know, like we talked about earlier, over 16 million, going to go over 20 million tomorrow with this thing, and every single dollar has gone to Sylvester. None of it's gone to administration fees. None of it's gone to setting up and all that stuff, and So I think, you know, there's very few events that I think give every single dollar that's given for the sole purpose of going to that charity actually goes to the charity. And that's another thing that's very special about this event.
Yeah, and that's, you know, like I had mentioned, you know, that's part because of the Miami Dolphins that helps us become as efficient, plus create such an amazing event, you know, with what they can do.
Am I right, Michael, that this is the biggest fundraising event of any team in the National Football League?
Absolutely. Actually, believe it or not, we're going to meet with the Eagles on Friday. So the Philadelphia Eagles have contacted us about creating something similar up there in Philadelphia. Yeah. And I think what a testament to how others are viewing the Miami Dolphins as the standard, the gold standard out there. And so they met with us a couple times. We want to give them as much information as possible. Yeah. We don't see it as a competition.
Well, look, you'd like to see, I mean, quite frankly, you'd like to see, you know, in due time, you know, every team in the National Football League do it. No reason that they can't do it. I know the San Diego Padres started a ride last year.
Correct.
Along the same lines, but there's no reason that, you know, every NFL, and can you imagine the money that would be raised if every team, you know, 32 rides around the country, you know, through the NFL participation. So yeah, I'm with you. I mean, the more the merrier. You know, the more teams that they want to get involved, and the more teams that look at this as a template for what they can do, I think the better it is for everybody.
Yeah, so I mean, everyone from ownership is involved in it. You know, down to their president and CEO and staff, they're really bought in.
Yeah.
So they're coming to really, you know, shadow us.
Yeah.
And the end ride,
and get a good
real feel.
Any of them riding?
Anyone what?
Any from Philadelphia riding?
Yeah, actually, their Don Smolensky, their president, is riding the 52-mile Boca ride, and I think a few others are doing the Fort Lauderdale ride with you. So I'm curious if they're going to be wearing a whole bunch of Philadelphia Eagle gear.
That's all right. That's all right. Yeah, we're all, as long as they don't wear New England stuff, we're good to go. Or Jet stuff, I guess.
Yeah, exactly.
It gets a little touchy there. You're watching the Audible here. If you're watching it with our good friends from Macofina, if you're watching it on Periscope, you can send your questions in the abridged way to do it, just at the bottom of your Periscope page. Right, Leon? That's how you do it? Just look at the bottom there and send a message in. If you don't have if you've heard us on Twitter, or if you heard something about us on Twitter, which I thought was going on for the last, you know, 3 or 4 months, open up a Periscope account, watch us on Periscope, and then you can go ahead and do it that way. You can see us on a delayed broadcast tomorrow on the Miami Dolphins Facebook page, always on MiamiDolphins.com. At King Edlin, do we stay at 22 in the draft, or we try to move up to get a premier linebacker? I don't, you know, I think the Dolphins need to stay right about where they're at. I don't think they can start, you know, they need numbers and they need depth. I don't think that this coaching staff or Mike Tannenbaum and Chris Greer and those guys, I don't think they're going to be in the league of trading a lot to move way up in the draft. I wouldn't be less surprised if they moved down than moved up to pick more picks. Soundman 1024, is Trey riding this weekend? Where's Trey at back there? Trey, you riding?
I see a lot of no's.
You see three guys. You see three guys back there, right?
You know, they say they have to work. Huh? They say they got to film us. Like you and me.
Three of the most fat, out of shape, non-athletic people I've ever met in my life, back in that room right now. You know, they may be conditioned to ride a bike. They may have the conditioning. I don't think they've got the dexterity or the physical prowess to actually get on a bike and ride it without falling over.
That's a challenge.
Well, they're a challenge group. They're a challenge group back there. Look at them. Look at them, huh?
Yeah, I see a lot of downward heads.
They blush when they look at the Three Stooges, those guys. at Light on the Dome, I'm thinking of participating next year. When should I start training? And any tips?
Well, I think there's a couple answers to that. One depends on where your current status is. Then I would say second is, how far do you want to reach? Yeah. Do you want to go up to 100 miles and you've never ridden them?
You better start working now.
You better start soon.
Yeah.
But if if you stay fairly fit and you're only trying to do, say a 25 or 35 miles, I think only a few times on the bike and you'd be more than good.
The other thing about it is that, since I started riding in this 6-7 years ago, I've gotten in better condition.
Yeah.
Beyond what's being raised and beyond what it does for cancer research, it's done a lot for me, just getting me back into shape and keeping me in shape. And because in the back of my mind, I always know that the ride's coming up.
Yeah.
So I got to get in. Even if I don't get on my bike and ride, I'll go to the gym. I'll ride in a stationary bike, do some interval training there, and do those kind of things. So, like you said, depending on how long you want to ride or how long you want to go, but I would say this, go find a nice bike. Get yourself invested in a good bike. Make sure that it's set up for you. Make sure that it's fit for you. Taking it somewhere and have them fit for you, then you're more efficient riding. It's more comfortable riding. And man, these bikes now, it's amazing.
Some of them are like 10 pounds.
It's amazing. When I first started riding, I had an old steel 10-speed with the shifters down on the tube.
That's antiquated.
Yeah, and
now they have electronic gears. Oh,
I got in one of those other bikes. I got in the bike I got right now. I'm like, oh my gosh, it's like jumping into a Ferrari or something.
Yeah, you start feeling like, wow, I'm going faster and I'm not. I'm working actually less.
Yeah, well, you know what's amazing is you go. It always amazes me how far you can coast on those things.
Yes,
you know what I mean.
Well, you want it, and you learn the art of drafting too.
Yeah,
because I know a lot of people, give you a lot of crap because they draft behind,
Yes, yes.
Dwight Stevenson.
I feel like I'm the
Pied
Piper. I'm out there busting through the wind, and I look back, and there's a train of people.
Always, sticking with a group is gonna help, and I think it just becomes
more enjoyable. Yeah,
you get to conversate a little bit, and again, this is a ride, not a race. We have a fully supported ride throughout shutting down roads.
Well, that's the other thing too. When you talk about riding, and somebody asked me the other day. They said, "Are you gonna ride?" Yeah, I go, "Well, how do you know where you're going?" I said, "Look, the ride's fully marked out. Every 20 miles or 15 or 20 miles, there's a rest stop. Mm-hmm. You know when that's coming up. A lot of the roads are blocked off where you can, you've got maybe a full lane where you can go. So, and it's done as safely as possible. Look, things are going to happen. You get 3,500 or 3,000 people out there riding bikes in the street.
Sometimes your biggest enemy is the other biker.
Well, that's it. No doubt about
it. It's not necessarily the cars, the police, over time, you start dazing off, and you don't think for a second.
Well, you know what's funny? I had this conversation with Nat the first guy, and the route has changed a bit. But I remember leaving the first time I rode. We went 100 miles. Nat and I rode kind of together. You leave the stadium, you go south down through Miami, through Coconut Grove, and then you go back all the way up through Palm Beach. And we got done. Nat said, he said, you know what? One of the most amazing things was all the socioeconomic
changes
that you've gone through. You go through a part of Overtown, Liberty City. You go through some of those areas. And look, you go through and people are on the sidewalk, they're clapping, they're cheering for you.
Let's go, Dolphins!
Thing. Yeah, the whole thing. And then you end up coming up... coming up through Miami Beach, Coconut Grove, and you end up in Palm Beach where you're riding. You were a few hours ago down by the stadium and down in parts of Miami, And then all of a sudden you're riding behind these multi-million dollar mansions with the ocean here, and you're going, wow, what a day this has been, man.
I know. That's part of the beauty of it. And because cancer does, it affects anyone. Yep. It doesn't care if you have $1 billion or $1.
Yep.
You know, it just doesn't really work that way. If you're young, old,
yeah, rich, everybody,
poor,
yeah.
Hispanic, white,
yeah,
black.
Look, we've both been with you and your father and me with my wife, and where you've gone into a room where everyone's getting chemotherapy, and you sit there and you look around. There's young kids, there's old people, there's firemen, yeah. There's people with a lot of money, there's people with no money. It doesn't matter.
I mean, it's not
discriminate at all. All right, let's kind of wrap this thing up with El Chapo Jr. Is it too late to get tickets for the Counting Crow concert?
No, you can go on to DolphinsCancerChallenge.com. And the beauty of going on and purchasing the $50 friends and family ticket is you get food and beverage included, with the purchase of the ticket. So it's a great deal. I mean, where you can get food, beverage, and a ticket to a great concert.
You just showed me a picture of the way the concert stage is all set up.
It's being built
right
as we speak.
Right in the 50-yard line. Facing the Dolphins side of the stadium.
Yep.
It's going to be a great concert, and the bike ride's going to end right behind the stage there in the stadium. So you ride into the stadium, which haven't been able to do in the last few years with the construction, but here we are now. It's going to be fun to get
back
in there.
That's what I'm pretty excited about that.
Yeah.
You know, coming back, because we did have to finish outside the stadium for obvious reasons, but it's what experience. I mean, it's so unique to have that, because there's thousands of bike rides around this country. Not many finish in a stadium.
Exactly. That's right. All right, Michael. Good job again.
Sir.
Good job again by you. I know it's going to be a great and successful ride again on Saturday. And again, there's still time to get involved, whether you want to ride, whether you want to walk, whether you want to do the 5K, whether you want to just go on DolphinsCancerChallenge.com and look for somebody, tag onto them and donate $10, $20, $5, whatever it is. Every dollar helps, and then you can be part of this great event and raising the kind of money that it's done now for the last 6 years and will continue to do here down in South Florida. So be a part of it in whatever way you can. And nothing's too small, and certainly nothing is too big when it comes to participating. So, Michael, good job by you again, and we'll be back.
It's a team effort. Yep. I want to say there are hundreds of people that make this possible.
Well, you know, you see it when you ride. Seeing you ride and you pull into those rest stops and all the volunteers.
I see Todd Boyan everywhere. I don't know how he gets all over.
How many volunteers will participate in this
on Saturday?
Almost 1,000 volunteers.
Almost 1,000 volunteers cutting bananas, oranges,
everything.
Filling up your water bottles, giving you a cold towel, you name it.
Well, I tell you, you get late in that ride, nothing better than seeing those rest stops.
And the massage at the end, too. You know, you get that good massage.
Yep. All right, that's going to do it for the Audible. Let me remind you. What's that, Leon? Oh, okay. You know what? You can check during the ride. Go to MiamiDolphins.com, and there'll be a lot of look. They got Trey will be out there. Logan will be out there with the cameras, hanging out of cars and stuff like that. They can't ride a bike; they're a little too fast, so they'll just get in the cars and they'll take video and do all that kind of stuff. And so you can see all that on social media, whether it's the Dolphins Instagram, Facebook, wherever the Dolphins are, you'll be able to see a lot of stuff on the Dolphins Cancer Challenge here on Saturday. So go ahead and stay. You know what? The more you watch, the more you're going to like it, the more you'll get involved next time. Leon, you're going to ride next year? How far, Leon? 150. Leon's in for 150 miles next year.
All right.
He's just going to keep riding that right through the stadium and keep going another 50 miles.
Like Forrest Gump.
Hell, we're stopping. That's it. Just keep on going. Trey's going to ride around the parking lot. Logan, he ain't going to go anywhere. All right, that's going to do it for the Audible. Let me remind you, on Friday, I believe we're going to be on there at 3:30, right, right, Leon? 3:30. All right, that's going to do it for all the boys in the back. Michael Mandich, always a pleasure.
Kim
Bokamper, we'll see you Friday on the Audible.